Now for today's program. Today's Zoominar is part of the Wide River Project, a year-long joint initiative of Western State Center and Moment Magazine that takes a deep dive and fresh look into the art, history, and issues that both unite and divide the Black and Jewish communities. Eric K. Ward, Executive Director of Western State Center and Senior Fellow with the Southern Poverty Law Center and Race Forward, and Nadine Epstein, Editor-in-Chief of Moment Magazine and Founder and Executive Director of the Center for Creative Change, will be joined today by Loren Schoenberg, Senior Scholar at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. Loren is also on the faculty at the Juilliard School and has lectured at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the White House, and the New York Philharmonic. He has conducted the Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra and the Smithsonian Jazz Masterworks Orchestra, among many others. Loren, a tenor and saxophonist and pianist, has played and recorded with many artists, including Benny Goodman, and for 9 years oversaw the Benny Goodman Archives at Yale University. He was also musical director for Bobby Short for 8 years. In addition to receiving 2 Grammy Awards for Best Album Notes in 1994 and 2004, Loren has been published widely, including his book, The NPR Guide to Jazz. In 2001, he helped lead the effort to establish the National Jazz Museum in Harlem and served for over a decade as its executive director, creating many of its signature programs and enlisted Christian McBride, Jonathan Batiste, Ken Burns, and Wynton Marsalis to the museum's mission. Before we welcome our speakers today, we're going to play a very short clip of the song Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho, which was first published in the late 1880s. The version you're about to hear was recorded by American gospel singer Mahalia Jackson and sung on the Nat King Cole Show in 1957.
The Battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down. Hallelujah. Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, and the world came tumbling down. You may talk about the men of Gideon, you may talk about the men of Saul, but they're none like the good old Joshua. The Battle of Jericho, that morning, Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho, and the world came tumbling down. Hallelujah.
That beautiful piece of music we just heard was a really wonderful way to start our conversation, because it's a piece of music from the early 19th century, and it is an important spiritual, and it is one that really, I think, maybe begins the conversation about the many channels of the Black Jewish relationship through music in the United States. And yes. And I thought, actually, Eric, you mentioned earlier that this was a piece of music that you grew up with. Tell us a little bit, when did you first hear it?
Yeah, first in church, right? As a young kid growing up, right? It wasn't the only one, right? So Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho, but also Balm and Gilead, Deep River, Down by the Riverside, Ezekiel Saw the Wheel, Give Me That Old Time Religion, right? Roll, Jordan, Roll. Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child. These were all the songs that I grew up with as a kid, and never realized the connection between the Black and Jewish community. I saw earlier, we had a post step up, but it's these songs are so powerful.
I actually, I was looking at Moment in an article in 2004, exploring the roots of rhythm and blues and the Jewish relationship and the Black relationship. And I thought, actually, there was a wonderful description in that article, which was how African-American music began with Southern slaves who transformed the syncopated drumming and a cappella folk songs from their African heritage into field hollers, the rhythmic call and response songs, and spirituals, religious songs that identified with the Old Testament and the Israelites in Egypt and expressed faith and a salvation in heaven. And yeah.
It's you know, they were, these songs were so influential. They had a long history, right? These were spirituals, which were an oral tradition. So these were songs that were passed down orally, and they were a mixture, right, of African culture, right, drawing off of Jewish liberation, right, symbols. And an analogy, right? They, as you said, right, the hymns, right, the spirituals used to call and response. And they usually take the form, right, three forms. So there's the verse only spirituals, right? There's the verse plus refrain spirituals, which we hear in Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, right? And then there's the refrain only, right, where it's just a strong statement. But these were stories that were about liberation, right? Not only were they sung to keep spirits high, but they also communicated things like escape routes, right? When people were fleeing, how to flee, who were friendly, white folks or other folks held in captivity who would be helpful, who were dangers. There was so much coding within these verses and spirituals. But it's amazing because we are now finding out today, well, for some folks, it'll be new, how much it was grounded in traditional languages of the Torah and eventually expressed themselves through Black music as well, not only through spirituals, but through blues and jazz. And of course, there's another layer to this, which is some of these songs, right, and bands and music were some of the basis of Black and Jewish relationships and tensions, not just in politics, but the tensions and the relationships also exist in cultural formats. And that's what we're seeing when we hear Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho.
What Eric brought up, of course, you know, the imposition of a Du Boisian double consciousness almost when we listen and look at these things. And so, you know, in terms of it, it seems like there's two or three different levels here that we're talking about. There's the musicological level, which we're not going to get in today, you know, analyzing the rhythm and the melody and all that. That's not appropriate. There's the fact of the Old Testament and all that, and as Eric mentioned, and how they're coded. And so many times it's not really, I don't think people, it's not so much about the Old Testament, it's more about how are we gonna survive today. And then you start to broach the issue of the social intercourse and between Blacks and Jews and how and when that happened and what happened in the business relationships, what happens. Stanley Crouch, my friend, has written brilliantly about these things, about the merging, about the similarities, about the differences. And my only voice here, kind of like always, is the doubting Thomas or something like that, or doubting Loren, is it's just along the lines of not to sugarcoat it, and of course we're not, try and look at the whole thing in a meta level or in confronting minstrelsy and confronting all the things that happened then. And of course, the miracle of the Fisk Jubilee Singers, which of course played such a large role.
Well, tell us a little bit about, let's focus right now on the spiritual. We're gonna get to the music industry in a few minutes, I promise you, but let's, tell us a tiny bit about the Jubilee Singers before we move on to a
couple. Sure, of course. Well, you know, after the end of the Civil War, there were all these now what we call HPCs, and Fisk University was one of them, very, very well known, and they had a choir, and they had a chorus, and they became very famous, and they were not singing the music of the Black Church. They were not singing those things which they were singing Christian hymns and all those things. And the way the story goes, as far as I understand, if anyone wants to jump in with with more details, I would welcome them. There, but what I do know is that when they ran out of things to sing, they had to do encores. And the encores were these spirituals. And that eventually it was the tail that wagged the dog or something like that. And it was the spirituals that people wanted to hear. And that's the roots of what we call gospel music. And of course, Dvorak, Antonin Dvorak, when he came over to America in 1893 to teach American composers how to write quote unquote classical music, they prepared, the woman named Jeanette Thurber put together a fascinating group of young people to study, including African-Americans and women, two groups which ordinarily would have been excluded from the high realms of perceived art music in America at the end of the 19th century. And to make a long, long story short, I'll paraphrase Dvorak famously. They said, well, tell us how you're going to teach these people to write quote unquote classical music. He said, give me a couple of weeks. Well, they had assigned someone named Harry T. Burley to be his assistant. And Will Marion Cook and many other people were around this circle of people around Dvorak. And Dvorak came back a couple of weeks later, again, paraphrasing, and he said, look, I can teach you how to write music. Like we write it over where we have an aristocracy. You have the seeds of your own genius music here in Negro spirituals and also in the music of Native Americans. So why don't you develop that stuff? And of course, the ultimate flowering of that would have been ultimately James Reese Europe, and then especially Duke Ellington. And then later on, when we get into the music business, then we can talk about the role that Jewish folks had in the careers of Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington, but that's for later.
Yes, they do that later. So I have a quick question before we go further, is that I'm all fascinated by the role of the Jordan River. There's so many songs where you hear the Jordan River. And so I've heard that, you know, the reason rivers were incredibly important, partly because it was coding in the music, but it was rivers were, if you could get to a river, you could lose the bloodhounds that were chasing you.
And the way to the water.
Huge, yeah, the water plays this huge role in these early spirituals. And it's always often phrased in that kind of biblical rivers. Which I find fascinating. I don't know what you guys think of that.
Yeah, parting the waters, right? It is, much of it is reference, right? To the parting of the Red Seas, right? The fleeing of the Pharaoh and his armies, right? Into the wilderness and eventually into liberation. These language, you know, the language usage is so dominant within spirituals. Now, some of this had to do with the fact, right, that the versions of the Christian Bible that those who were held in captivity were allowed to see, right, were deeply censored books, right, rarely read, primarily transferred through oral tradition, right, and so the references to liberation, right, lamps, water, movement, the prophets, right? Often named Ezekiel, Joshua, others, I think is right. But these were also stories about how to follow the moon, right? When to flee, right? It wasn't just instructions, but often those who were leading people into liberty, right? Out of slavery would use songs as a way of calling people, letting them know, right, that freedom was at hand. And so the meaning of water as transformation, as cleansing, I think cannot be overstated within the spirituals. And I think it's important also, Nadine, I don't want to talk too long, but many of these spirituals are still sung, right, in Black churches today. There are still many of the most popular songs. Hundreds of years, right now we're getting into hundreds of years old in terms of some of them. It shows the power of those lyrics even today.
Well, let's take a quick pause and listen to one more spiritual, and that's Go Down Moses. Mm-hmm. So, and there are of course so many different versions of it, but we chose Louis Armstrong.
Now, Now when Israel was in Egypt land,
let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand,
let my people go.
So the Lord said, go down,
go down,
Moses,
Moses,
way,
way
down,
down
in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
It's so amazing. So I don't know how many of you here today celebrated a Passover Seder on Friday night and Saturday night, but at so many Seders, people sing the song now. And actually, that's been happening since around the 1940s, where this first became a tradition in the Reform tradition and Reconstructionist traditions to begin to sing, to include this. And so, you know, here's an African-American spiritual that was influenced by the Old Testament, you know, symbols and stories that's now found its way into a Jewish ritual itself, which is the Passover Seder. And it's in many, many Haggadot. So it's, you know, one of those incredibly circuitous ways the world influence, cultures influence each other. Was this a song that you were familiar with growing up too, Eric?
Absolutely. I think, again, a super powerful song. Of course, I know the version from Louis Armstrong. It's funny. I know that much more as a jazz standard. Isn't that interesting? So that's not a song I heard in church a lot, but it is a song that I heard on many a record player growing up. In a lot of households in my family. So Louis Armstrong, well-known, of course, and of course, Moses, let my people go. It's interesting, right, as we start to kind of get into the conversation, right, we'll learn a few things, right, that music and culture has intertwined Black and Jewish communities in fascinating ways, right? But it also has influenced folks outside, right? This tradition, right, this kind of shared double consciousness continues to play itself out, right, even into the 1960s, where you see Bob Dylan, right, engage, right, with the Black community around the civil rights struggle, right, through song, right, a Jewish singer-songwriter who then helped inspire other folk musicians to do the same. But I also think of Pete Seeger, who is not Jewish, right, who isn't Black, right, who wrote some of the most popular civil rights songs, right, of the era, Keep Your Eyes on the Prize being one of them, Hold On. And Pete Seeger, for those who don't know, right, developed his own tradition, oral tradition around folk music from attending Jewish camps. He traveled around visiting Jewish summer camps where he actually picked up the importance of oral tradition, right, and binding songs towards liberation. So we're really starting to see the influence unfold here.
That's amazing. Well, I want to switch to jazz in a minute, which, yes. I know Loren has a lot to say, but before we do that, you know, there was a transition around the 1890s where spiritual songs started becoming blues, and then it got guitar became added. And then there's also this transition when there's this urban migration of Blacks to cities from rural areas in the South, some in the North, some in the South, where there's also another transition occurs. But let's take a pause. And I know we're going to get into rhythm and blues in a minute, but I just wanted to talk about jazz first. The only reason I'm doing this is because jazz actually really kind of develops maybe first, and then rhythm and blues, which eventually becomes rock, starts in the 40s. So Loren, can you tell us a little bit about the influence? Like, so jazz, you know, obviously has so many influences. Tell us a little bit how it starts, and then we're going to play a little piece of music after that. So.
Well, I'd go back a little bit, and I'd step back just a little bit. I don't think the spirituals became blues, frankly.
Okay.
I mean, I understand where you're going with that. But they were really two very, very, very distinct things. And one was sacred and one was profane. And there were a whole bunch of people, the great majority of folks, who would identify themselves as religious African-American folks. No blues in the house, no blues allowed. And so they really are kind of two separate things. I tend to look at things a little bit differently. And this will go back to Eric and your conversation about water. And it's the metaphor, which certainly is not original with me, but I use it, which is to think of African-American culture and American culture, to think of it as a large river. And that these way stations in the river are, for the most part, imposed by the music industry and imposed by people trying to define things so it becomes Coke versus Pepsi or this versus that. And the way that I like to look at it, it's really one stream and various parts of the stream have more elements of one than the other. But I think it's a more holistic way to kind of look at it and to also to think of maybe the relationship between African-Americans and Jewish people. You see, now, but even that is such a messed up way of saying it. After because...
Car insurance from Liberty Mutual?
I'm sorry, what?
I don't know what, that was just a sound that interfered.
Oh, I'm sorry. If we use the word African-American and then we use the word Jewish, well, Jewish is a religion, although it's kind of a cultural thing. And so to think of a river maybe in terms of the relationship between these communities and to try and tell the story maybe in a new and fresh way, not relying so much on the old cliches.
Well, what we've been trying to do in this whole project, it's called the Wide River Project for that exact reason. And what
there
we're trying to do is identify some of the channels. We know it's a wide river, but we're kind of just looking at some of the channels that we might not notice. And I only created sort of this just to provide some arc for our conversation.
Of course. You have to start somewhere and there has to be some order to it.
So I totally agree that this is a construction, it's a social construction, a construction right. for our conversation.
I'll say one thing, which is that, listening to Mahalia Jackson at the beginning, I think anybody that plays jazz music, whether they know it or not, has one foot in the African-American church of the 19th century, whether they know it or not. And if they, and even if the music has gotten so abstract or so removed from it, they still have a foot there. And maybe they choose not to admit it, because the whole rhythmic basis of all the musics that you were talking about, and it was interesting to hear it, in other words, the way these various things evolve, that whole thing, if you could look at the whole planet, as far as I know, and say, where did that come from? Where did that rhythm come from? Where's the first time I remember you were talking about John Baptiste before. And I remember, many, many years ago, he sat at the piano and he played a little boogie-woogie bass line, boom, 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 boom. And he said, I wonder when the first person to do that on the piano, it could have been, Lord knows where it was, But anyway, but getting back to your question,
so tell us about the Black influence on jazz. Just give us what's the relationship between the African-American music and jazz? And then we'll get into the intersection with the Jewish world a little bit.
Sure, of course. Basically speaking, in the 19th century, the overwhelming popular music of America and the tradition of entertainment devolved into something called minstrelsy. At which point there were pictures and music written that kind of imitated the sounds of African-American culture and in many ways cut it off at the neck and was kind of false in a certain kind of way. And then eventually it evolved to the point where African-American folks, to get into the quote-unquote mainstream of entertainment, would have to participate in this demeaning ritual. What happened, though, and this is something that's still so much of an issue, there were geniuses there, and there were incredibly creative people there involved in these processes. And by the early early 20th century, and I'm not going to make this too long, it'll just be maybe 104 seconds or something like that. But at the beginning of the 20th century, all of a sudden, ragtime kind of hit. And all of a sudden, it was a music that was written by African-American folks. And it was music that redefined the whole concept of, no, we don't want to hear the songs about going back down south, and we don't want to hear, all those things, and Stephen Foster things, and all those things. This is composed music, and this is to be approached in the same way that you approach because of America's natural cultural insecurity, that somehow classical music is better, or things that come from Europe are better. And so consequently, you get this really kind of intricate musical ragtime. And then you start to get musicians improvising off of ragtime. And then you start to get composers like Jelly Roll Morton, who start to compose. Oh, now this is like a layered cake. Ragtime is written. You start to get early musicians who improvise off of the written ragtime. Then you get a composer like Jelly Roll Morton, who starts to compose off of the improvisation, off of the written music. And then you get another layer of musicians, and eventually you get a Duke Ellington, who still has to really get his role as a great civil rights figure, which of course he was. And so as this evolves, all of a sudden you get a genius pops out, a whole bunch of geniuses pop out. But the main one is Louis Armstrong. And that's a whole other story how and why that happened. And so all of a sudden now you have a music that is ironic in nature and sophisticated, and at the same time, tremendously popular with the masses. And so there's just a hop, a skip, and a jump to understand who Duke Ellington is, who Paul Robeson is, and all these various things. And I'll end with one very short anecdote. It doesn't make a difference if it's apocryphal, because something like it did happen. And the story is this. Armstrong's records come out in the 1920s, and he's scat singing, as we know, and words and sounds. His music, jazz, was received at that time much the way that rap music was received. And you almost do a find and replace. And actually, with any African-American music that's eventually commodified. And so what happened was, the story goes, whether it's in America, whether it's in any continent, this story exists. The young person is listening to a Louis Armstrong record in the 1920s. The trumpet's going all over the place. He's singing, rah, 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 he's singing, scat singing. His parents don't like it. The next generation, what the heck? What are you listening to? What is that stuff you're listening to? And invariably, one of the older generation comes by, the grandparent, and hears Armstrong's voice and turns to the young person and says, he sounds like one of us. Which means that Armstrong had hit on what Chaplin hit on, and had hit on what all the great painters had hit on, and what all the great griots of the 19th century, if they had been recorded, hit on, what the great religious leaders hit on. He had a way of expressing the human experience in a way that spoke around the world. And I was once asked in a book by a friend of mine who wrote a book about Duke Ellington's sacred music, about my own religious stuff. And I basically said, if I had a religion, it would be Louis Armstrong.
Well, that's amazing. So we're gonna talk about the jazz industry in a minute. But I thought, let's play one more. We're gonna play one more song. I think it's the song we mistakenly played at the beginning.
Yes.
Which I think will lead us into a little conversation about how there may be a little Jewish influence on jazz at a certain point. Let's see.
Of all the boys I've known, and I've known some, until I first met you, I was lonesome. And when you came in sight, dear, my heart grew light, and this old world seemed new to me. You're really swell, I have to admit you deserve expressions that really fit you. And so I racked my brain hoping to explain all the things that you do to me. By mere Bist of Shein, please let me explained by mere Bister Shein means that you're grand. By mere Bister Shein, again I'll explain, it means you're the fairest in the land. I could say Bella, Bella, even say Wunderbar. Each language only helps me tell you how grand you are. I've tried to explain by mere Bister Shein, so kiss me and say you understand.
Well, so it's such a great song, and Ella Fitzgerald is another one of those incredible geniuses who appears out of this whole movement. Yeah. But it adds a little telus, so it's got this little klezmer. So I guess jazz comes to New York at a certain point, and it meets Jewish performers and Jewish composers and this Jewish tradition of klezmer. How was there kind of how did this connection happen?
And Nadine, I want to add in to Loren before you answer some other pieces. So this song, I think, is written in the 1930s, right? Or it's performed by Ella Fitzgerald. And I got to give a little love shout to my dad, right? A huge fan of Ella Fitzgerald. He's 97. My dad will be 97 this October. And Ella Fitzgerald lived in West LA during some of the last portions of her life. And he has some fascinating stories. But what's amazing to me is 1937, she is singing Yiddish, or at least by mir vos Dr. Duchain, which I thought my entire life was hello, Mr. Shein. I thought that was the line. I bet a lot of people did. It wasn't until a film came out in the 90s called Swing Kids,
which was
about German youth, right, who loved jazz. They were jazz kids. During the rise of Nazi Germany, and jazz was their form of resistance. It was the way that they knew how to resist and explain what was happening around them, Loren. So I'm super curious. Here we have what appears to be a Yiddish line, 1937. Jazz is clearly transforming. What's going on? Nadine asked the perfect question.
Well, a couple of things. First of all, there was a wonderful... I think I'm older than you folks. In New York, back in the 60s and the 70s, was a wonderful late night radio host named Gene Shepard. And he used to, and he thought it was called The Bear Missed the Train. The Bear Missed the Train. You know, how a bear could make a train. And I actually worked with Ella Fitzgerald. I'm proud to say.
Wow.
But the truth is, I was trying to think of a good analogy, and the one I came up with would be that if you had a wonderful chef who was a master of Southern cuisine and okra and gumbo and the roux and the whole wonderful cuisine of the South, and then they ate a matzo ball soup, and they liked it. And the next time they cook some wonderful meal, they just like, you know what, maybe I'll add a little bit of this. That's about the influence of Jewish music on jazz as far as I'm concerned. I really don't think it's there. What that is, frankly, are Jewish songwriters writing a song, and then the Andrews sisters and the people who own the music industry pushed this song. And Benny Goodman's trumpet player Ziggy Elman famously started playing these things. But in terms of a Jewish influence on the serious part of what jazz is musically, culturally, and all those things, I really don't think it's there. I'll be honest with you. The one thing that usually comes up in this discussion is the sound of the cantor and the geschrei, I think is the Latin term. And all this kind of stuff. And that somehow that's what we hear in jazz music. I don't think that that's where it comes from at all. I think any group of people who have been through what the Jews went through and what people are going through right now all over the world in those kinds of situations tend to moan when they sing, but I don't make more of it than that. But there are many people who do. I think I appeared in a documentary film that's all about this great connection, but I'm the naysayer.
And I think if you look, we did this wonderful moment, did something called the Soundtrack of the Jewish People, where we interviewed a lot of really interesting people, Jewish and not, and they asked them to choose what the song that they thought was most Jewish. And you know, there's quite a lot of conversation about the cantorial voice and its influence. We can all agree to disagree on this one. We're talking about the influence of the music. And I wanna step back a little bit to talk about the 1940s. And in this conversation, we're gonna get into the industry. And I know we can go back to jazz a little bit too, but in the 1940s, basically, from my understanding, from articles I've read and written, major record labels drop Black music. They drop gospel music. There's a war going on. You need shellac to, you know, create records. Shellac is in short demand. And there's this whole transformation then of small, independent Jewish producers who are mostly poor Jews who get into this business and start producing music. And I want to just say right up front that one of them is my cousin who just passed away on Friday, Art Rupp, who was at 104, and he was the founder of Specialty Records. And so he was a small town. He grew up in a small town in Pennsylvania. And he was the star Hebrew school student. And the temple offered him a scholarship to become a rabbi and go to college to become a rabbi. And he decided to go to Hollywood and get into the movies. And somehow he got into doing music instead. And that was because, and I'm gonna read this quote because it's just, such a sweet quote from an interview I did with him a few years ago, where he talks about growing up in McKeesport, Pennsylvania. And he says, there was a tremendous amount of ethnic intermingling. In a picture I remember seeing of me with my classmates, I looked like the sugar cube in a coal bin. We were all poor, and whether white or Black, aspects of our culture were the same. I particularly enjoyed listening to blues records in one of my Black friends' homes. What bonded us was the culture shaped by our similar economic status, not our ethnicity. And so he and I went back to McKeesport and we went to the church where he first heard gospel music, which happened to be down the street from his house. And so when he got out here, he started producing gospel music. And he is one of, you know, many, but he's just the one I know most personally. So this is the beginning. So I just wanted to share that story with all of you. Loren, would you like to say something? Yeah.
I want to go back because we actually did miss something very, very important that I neglected to mention in terms of Blacks, African-Americans, and Jewish people. One would be the songwriters who wrote the music that most of the great jazz performances were based on, which would be Richard Rodgers and Jerome Kern and George Gershwin and Irving Berlin and those people. So that's a place where you do really get a mixing. I mean, Irving Berlin's first hit was An Imitation of a Black Song, which was Alexander's Ragtime Band, okay? Then you have Benny Goodman, who famously integrates his band in 1937 and hires two African-American musicians at that time, who I knew very well, and they felt that everyone talked about Jackie Robinson joining the Dodgers in 1947, but when Lionel Hampton and Teddy Wilson joined Benny Goodman's band, that was a huge, huge, huge moment. And I think that that's where, if you really want to talk about the Jewish influence on jazz, it's not so much musical, in my estimation. It's cultural, has to do with the business. And then we have to frankly say that the story of those, and I know nothing about your uncle and what he did, but generally speaking, the story of those Jewish record companies who recorded the Black artists is not a great story for Jews, frankly. It's complicated. And so those are just some of the things, in all frankness, that I'd like to throw out here as we discuss these things.
Well, we're absolutely going to discuss both the, there's again, many people who believe that, and I guess it's a little bit different from jazz and then the blues, the R&B period in the 40s. So, and I don't know as much about the jazz period, because obviously
of that notion that, that it's really not this period and that period and this period.
Okay.
It's much more this. It's much more this. And the steady stream of the way that the music business goes and the way that the money goes and the way that the publishing rights goes are really part of your river water metaphor.
Yes.
That flow pretty regularly throughout all these things. And so it's not quite as cut and dried. Frankly.
Never pretended, I never want to be ever pretending something is cut and dried. I totally agree. Eric, did you want to say something?
You know, I always have something to say, but it's really back to Loren, Nadine. I mean, it's fascinating. We get into this period. So I was thinking Benny Goodman, right? But also the film, The Five Pennies, right? Which features, we're going back a little bit. I can't remember what year.
1959,
right? It features Louis Armstrong, and it, of course, you know, Danny Kaye has Red Nichols, one of the kind of phenomenal, I think, jazz movies of the period. But there are other films, right, that have been that have really come out. I think of Mo' Better Blues. I think of Ma Rainey, right? The new film. I'm spacing on others right now, Loren, because I'm nervous. I want to give it over to you. But there are a number of different kind of jazz films that have been produced probably over the last 40 years, right? And typically, right, they present the Black and Jewish relationship within those films as tenuous, right? And typically, I often say it's within that cinematography, right? Not always made by Black film producers. I think that's important to note, right? But sometimes that often it's where we see kind of the Jewish trope, right? Of the Jewish manager who's exploiting the artist, right? Who is taking money. And it seems to be the predominant trope. Can you help us untwine that and kind of put more nuance and complexity to what those relationships were like? Were they really unique? I imagine in that period, most Black artists were being exploited by the entertainment industry, whether those folks were Jewish or non-Jewish. But it often seems in the films that it is a very kind of Jewish caricature that's put into that position.
I think it's really important. It's the kind of anti-Semitism that we see. And, you know, I can just say from having, if you read this article that we did on Rhythms and Blues, how a bunch of upstart Jewish independent record producers helped turn African music into a national treasure. There, a lot of these were very tough deal makers. These were poor, they were almost all men, although there were a few women, very tough deal makers, but they weren't necessarily dishonest. And most of them were not dishonest. And when they actually, when the small independent producers went out of business at a certain point and went into the music industry changed, it's not clear that, you know, Black entertainers and performers did any better. For example, you know, for my cousin, Lloyd Price was one of the people that he brought, and Little Richard and Sam Cooke. And Lloyd Price is the one who spoke when he was, you know, inducted into the Hall of Fame, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, because he said that, you know, he was always paid on time. And he disagreed with the anti-Semitic trope that you know, all that he was being taken advantage, there was, he's being taken advantage of. So it's a really complicated question. And I see it from both sides. But Loren, did you have something you wanted to say about this? Because also this occurred in jazz as well.
You can really take that away. It's not in jazz. It's not in rock and roll. It's not in rhythm and blues. It's across the board.
It's in the music industry in general. There's a relationship between the producer and the artist.
Yeah, it's in America, and then it filters down to the entertainment industry, and then the people who happen to be in the entertainment industry, and then the people who happen to be in the part of the industry that they could break into. I'll disagree. I don't call those things anti-Semitic trope. I really don't. I don't think it's necessarily always true, but I think that's why I'd like to bring up and discuss, if we have time, and if we don't, that's fine. But I think it's important to talk about Joe Glazer and to talk about Irving Mills, because by talking about these two specific people, they can be kind of representative samples of how complicated this issue is. And if that's okay, I can take us there.
Well, let's do it just really briefly, because I want to get into today, which is a whole different story. And we want to leave some time for questions as well. Well, okay. I'm going to say that today is a different story. You may disagree, but so if you want to briefly tell us, yeah.
Okay. It's complicated. And this sounds like a silly thing to say, that there's no black and white. It's gray. It's a gray area, and it's full of contradictions, and it's full of all kinds of stuff that can't be neatly summarized. And so by talking about these two people, I think, and I'll try and do it very, very briefly. I'm a teacher myself, and many times I tell the students, be concise. So now I'm going to tell myself, just cut to the bone here. Okay. Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington, chances are, never would have had the opportunity to become who they became in the entertainment industry without a Jewish manager. That's a fact, because in those days, African-American entertainers were not given the opportunities that white folks were. So that's a fact, we all know that. So Irving Mills saw that Ellington was a genius, and for 10 years managed him and packaged him as a great genius of American music, at the same time taking half of all the money. Now, Ellington, no fool he, was well aware of this and was you see, this is where it's complicated. He was thankful for what Irving Mills did for him, because he never could have gotten there without a white hand on his shoulder, a Jewish hand who knew the mob and could do all the things that had to be done in the mob-ridden music industry. You want to talk about mob-ridden, then we can talk about rock and roll in the 50s and all those labels. Okay, so there's that. Louis Armstrong, same thing. An actual mob guy, Joe Glazer, saw a money ticket in Armstrong, and they were also friends at the same time, and helped push him up to the point where, as we all know, Armstrong became, along with Charlie Chaplin, probably the most recognized face on the planet Earth in the 1950s. Okay, so they were taken advantage of terribly. Without being taken advantage of, they never could have gotten where they got to. Given the way that things were, they had actually good relationships with these people. But all of it is true at the same time.
I think that's a wonderful encapsulation of the relationship. Those are great stories. Eric, do you want to add something before we move on to today?
We will move on today, but I think it's so important. I just wrote one thought in the chat, Nadine, which occurred to me as I was listening to Loren speak a little bit. You know, it made me wonder how much we've come to understand our relationship, right, in music and culture between the Black and Jewish community through the larger lens of what American society believes that relationship is, versus through our own, the lenses of our own communities. And Loren's the first person I've heard to kind of unpack the kind of nuance, I think he called it gray. But I find myself really excited to unpack that grayness, so that my lens is actually a lens that I've constructed between the Black and Jewish community and vice versa, rather than what larger society says, which is typically filled with these tropes and stereotypes.
Yes. Yeah. And I think there's also a point that we missed here. It's just that there was a reason why Blacks and Jews were together in the music industry. I mean, there were lots of Jews performing too. There were Black producers, there were Jewish producers, but that was because they weren't welcome in a lot of other industries. And there was this little niche where they, where you could go mainstream, where you could have, you could go into business, you could, and it was through this, through the arts. And I think that that's something that's we forget, and that's very important as well. Only because we have running out of time, because there's so much to say, and I would love to hear both of you so much more. I just want to bring us back to today. I'm just going to put out there, and I, Loren's going to disagree with me, but that's great. Is that there's, we're kind of in a period of fusion, that we have, you know, really changed. There's Blacks and who write and perform Jewish influenced music. There's Jews who've been performing Black influenced music. We have Jews of color in greater numbers than ever before, who are have having a huge impact. There are, there's musicians like Jerron Line Boy Paxton, who I know Eric went to see once, and we're going to hear from him in a second. Actually, why don't we hear from him right now, Suzanne?
Give the blues a chance, find a sunny place, go and paint your face with little sunshine. Pay your doctor bill, toss away his pill. You can cure your ill with a little sunshine. Why don't you take your teardrop one by one? Fold it to leave, hang them about in the sun so they evaporate.
It's so beautiful. So this is jazz, and this is today. And I just, you know, I know, how does this fit into the whole big picture?
Wow. I mean,
I don't know.
Well, let me throw out something. So there's also, there's like, we, again, we did this whole soundtrack of the Jewish people. We interviewed Anthony Mordecai's V. Russell, who does opera, and he chose Hava Nagila as the song that he thought was most important. We have Don Byron, who's been exploring klezmer. He's and the music of Mickey Katz. Nissan Black is the person who chose Hava Nagila. There's just so many. There's Drake. I'm just trying to think offhand, some of the people come to mind.
Diggs.
There's such a wide variety of music. We interviewed Leslie Odom Jr. and he chose Ma'atzur, which was a Jewish prayer as a song that he thought was incredibly important. So we just are in an era of more, it's like, it's almost like this wide river you've been describing, Loren, has just blossomed, has just widened even more.
I've learned a lot here, and I'm hungry to talk more with you and to talk with Eric, because this is going in a very interesting direction. And for all of the disagreements, I mean, that's only because you raise such interesting points. And frankly, to be able to talk about them at relatively long play level here is a joy, because it's something that we usually don't get to do. And so I just look forward to continuing this. I've got a lot to think about now.
Me too.
I mean,
yeah. I'm the possibilities, Nadine, are endless, right? There are questions here. There were real interactions that were happening here, and not just business, right? These were cultural influences from, we haven't even talked about, you know, those who fled the pogroms and the early rise of Nazi Germany, right? Professors who could only get jobs in Black colleges, right? An Ashkenazi Jewish community.
We're going to talk about that in another conversation.
In another conversation,
super
right?
Super important, yeah.
Right, there's placed in, you know, proximity to Jewish to Black communities. We see that in the film, the Palm the pawnbroker, right? Mm. We see hints of these things, but I think it's a field for as much has been written about it, and there's been a lot written, right? A lot of articles. The actual reflection around what it meant and what it means today, it is open. So there are about 325 participants listening right now. There are 325 opportunities to open up the space around this conversation.
Well, that's a great, what, Susan, oh, Loren, did you want to say something before?
No, I was just going to jump off on what Eric was saying, which is that this story that we're talking about has yet to be told. And it has yet to be told in a great film. It has yet to be told in a play. Well, there are some plays, but it's ripe for someone now to jump in and redefine it. And maybe one of these 325 people or the many other people that are related to them.
Well, that is what we've been trying to do in this whole series, which is going to be, it's a whole year long series and we have many more ahead of us. It's just sort of broaden this conversation of the river. I love the river. When we thought of the title in the beginning, I hadn't really thought about the importance of the river to the African-American spiritual, but I think it turns out to be just powerful. So I know there's a lot of questions, and Suzanne, would you like to pop in here and choose some questions?
Sure.
And please, everyone, feel free to send questions. And one of the things that we do, even if we can't get to your question, we're going to, on our website, the Wide River Project site, we will put the questions up, because sometimes the questions are just so amazing and so powerful.
Thank you. Thank you all for this fabulous conversation. Many people have asked for a part two, so we definitely could not get to everything today. One question that has come up, both folks typing in as well as ahead of time, was the question about cultural appropriation. And several people wondering if songs like having the Moses song in the Seder, is that cultural appropriation, and how do the different communities feel about that?
Eric, why don't you address that one?
You know, I was writing, it's interesting. We might consider it cultural appropriation, but then would the use of Moses be another form of cultural appropriation? And so what I said is likely, but I believe all music is built kind of like civilizations, right? Layered upon upon each other. So of course there's going to be borrowing. The real question isn't whether there's appropriation, but how we tie that appropriation, right, back to some context, right? That this is about Jewish struggle. This is about Black struggle. And those things should not be lost, right? As we utilize these very powerful songs of symbolism and inspiration. I don't know, Loren, what do you think?
No, I think you just said it. The way you were talking about the civilizations and all this, you said it as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you. Some people would like to know if you could share any stories about Louis Armstrong and his connection to the Jewish community, especially when he was growing up.
Well, there's a Louis Armstrong, almost not on his deathbed, but a year before, when he was at Mount Sinai Hospital here in New York, I had a Jewish doctor, and he wrote this story down. I guess maybe he had told it, and someone said, why don't you write it down? And he told this story about the Karnofsky family. Early on, they sold coal, and how Louis would, they were very kind to him, and he would come and sit at their table, and they would sing Jewish songs, and he would hear it. And how they welcomed him in with open arms, because they were both part of a very poor community in New Orleans. And later on, I met, there was a famous American historian named Stanley Karnow, and I met him in Washington, and he was a member of that family. And the story is not exactly quite the way that it has been put into stone, but the point is that there were many African-American jazz musicians, like Lionel Hampton, who consider themselves to be Jewish. And there's also another component, very, very briefly, which is the intellectual component, the study of the Talmud. The great writer Stanley Crouch, who I've mentioned already before, has written about this. And I think there was a certain kind of African-American person and a certain kind of Jewish person who kind of met at a certain point, because there is something about the sacred texts and the studying and all these kind of things. And it was a lot of Jewish musicians in the early 1920s were looking for a master, and that's a loaded word in American history, to teach them about African-American music. And the early African-American jazz musicians became the masters to these first generation Jewish kids and others. Mm-hmm. And so it's that's a great question.
Wow.
And there's also a record, by the way, of Billie Holiday singing My Yiddish Mama, but that's another story.
Oh, that's fabulous.
And actually somebody asked the question, when did Hava Nagila become popular for Black artists to sing? I know Harry Belafonte always sang that. Anybody know?
It's been a long time, but I don't know exactly when it's. But there's a film about Hava Nagila. We should. It's a great question.
That's a great question. That would be a great documentary.
Yeah. Well, I think there is a documentary, and it may be answered already. I don't know.
It may be answered.
And I do believe Harry Belafonte, I looked it up, he started singing it, I think it was 1958 or 57. And that became part of
a big birthday party here in New York, his 95th birthday concert that he attended. And I'll just say, just to be breathing the air in a world where there is a Harry Belafonte is something that we really need to treasure.
Mm-hmm. I want to throw out Sammy Davis Jr. Yes. So I didn't really overlap that much with Sammy Davis Jr., except when he was very old, but I just remember him performing, and he was wearing a Magen David, and he was so Jewish, and everyone just completely accepted him. He was just like, there was just no question. Sammy Davis was Jewish, wherever you were. And I felt like he got a completely different treatment. I don't know. So I don't know if anyone else has the same perception.
I mean, Sammy Davis Jr. had, it's very interesting, right? So the, Loren, I don't want to offend if I say this out loud, but you know, we have the Rat Pack, Dean Martin, right? Sammy Davis Jr. I think when they're a diverse group amongst themselves, right? But they're also super, they're super fascinating, right? That group, we'll set aside the misogyny, which we're not forgetting, right?
Yes.
we should talk about the deep misogyny and sexism. But in terms of racial politics or in terms of belonging, they had somewhat of an expansive understanding. And so it's not surprising that Sammy Davis Jr., right, finds a more direct path to Judaism. The truth is a conversation for another time, right? But within the Black community, within the Black cultural tradition, right, there are many paths upon which folks affiliate, right, to some aspects of Judaism as they understand it, whether we're talking about Rastafarianism, right, whether we're talking about the influence of British Israelism, right, on the Black spiritual tradition. We see this a lot. And so it's not surprising, right, in the United States, you see a number of African Americans, right, throughout the 50s and 60s till today, mm-hmm. right, mm-hmm. who are engaged in a process of conversion.
Yes, and I'll just add to that in Harlem, you know, at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, you know, there are many photos going back to the 1920s, a whole sect of African American Jewish folks, and I mean, Orthodox as heck, I mean, really, you know, way out there in terms of that stuff. A very strong tradition.
We've written some stories about the you know, first of all, the Old Testament in a lot of Black churches, and how a lot of churches were almost Jewish and then became Jewish. And we'll include that when we send that to you, because that's a really interesting story, and I think it does play a part of the musical story as well. But it's another question we should explore in this conversation as well, Eric, next time.
I know we are getting close on time, but I also have to ask Loren, lest I be forgetful. But it's interesting as jazz and blues begin to evolve in the 60s and 70s, right? It also opens up space where we see Jewish and Muslim jazz musicians taking the stage together in the United States and outside the United States as well.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that because a wonderful woman named Tracy Hyder Suffern has been the executive director of the Jazz Museum for quite a while now. And we have done a lot of program. In fact, it was really kind of hitting its stride right before the pandemic about this intersection of the Jewish and the Muslim world too. And so, jazz really is, in my estimation, it's my choice for the music that the equation of jazz is, as I see it, is the letter A is the great tradition of jazz, which is an African-American tradition, and the B is whatever the heck the culture is that is going to blend with it. And that what comes out, this letter C thing, and I should come up with a clever thing for C, I haven't thought of it yet, is that jazz is so malleable because it is the sound of surprise. It is the sound of freedom in a certain way. Vaclav Havel and so many people have talked about the jazz music that came over on the Voice of America broadcasts in Europe in the 50s. And they would hear these things and it was something about the freedom in it. And ultimately that's the freedom espoused by 19th century folks that we talked about, the African-American folks and yeah, it goes on forever. It's hard to wrap
it up. You've caught something so important. Music is freedom. I'm just going to ask one more question to you. You know, I know that, Loren, you knew George Wein. And who was really influential in jazz as well. Was he involved in bringing out, was he part of this conversation between Jews and
Muslims? Heck yeah, sure. I mean, George Wein, son of a Jewish doctor in Boston, married a Black woman, Joyce, who I knew very well. And they were two titans. They were very different. And so on his personal life, and they were married back in the 40s, I guess, or early 50s, in their personal lives, and then in terms of what he did with jazz music, were very, very much a part of it. And another great jazz musician going back to Ella Fitzgerald, was Norman Granz. And these were the people who would not have the music played at places that were segregated, that would, donate large amounts of money and be very, very actively involved in the civil rights movement and all that. And George Wein is very important and Norman Granz. I'm just going to put a small point there for myself to do a talk about it or for us. If you put Norman Granz and George Wein here, and then you take Joe Glazer, and Irving Mills here back in the 30s, there's four very interesting intersections of African-American culture, African-American music, civil rights, and Jewish manager people, frankly. So
I will end on this question. There's a generational dynamic. What is seen today through Black and Jewish lens is different from what today's generation may see. How do we reclaim the 60s era and alliances? And I will add, and how do we do that through music? Can it be done through music?
Yeah, so I think it's important to note, my sense is those things still very much exist. The cultural relationships still exist. Hip hop is one space that comes to mind, but so is the re-emerging house electronica music genres. And I think we spend too much time thinking about building things rather than recognizing this exists. They don't need us to create these spaces. What folks need is our time and investment, right, into the spaces that already exist. Blacks and Jews have always engaged culturally. I think what makes it harder in this moment is the rise of social media. We forget. We are often conditioned to see each other in specific ways through anti-Black and anti-Semitic tropes. And the way we reclaim those alliances is by building direct relationships. We can't do that through social media. We have to be in spaces together. Making music seems like a good idea.
And we focus on, this is the whole point of this project. It's so easy to focus on the negative channels. And we have such an incredible shared cultural legacy. And it's just important for us to bring it out. I don't think that shared legacy has gone anywhere. I think that there are so many pockets and so many channels where it's really alive. But we need to, we all need to explore it more.
Okay, Lauren, I'll let you have the last word.
It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Do-wah.
Perfect.
Oh, I'm sorry. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing.
A little bit of Yiddish. So I want to thank Loren and Eric and Nadine for this fabulous, fabulous conversation. I know a lot of people really enjoyed it. I want to encourage people, if you're in New York, go to the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. I'm sure you will very much enjoy it. We will send out an email later this week that will include a link to today's recording. And I'll be sure that I include a lot of the things that Eric sent in the chat with the different movies and different ideas and stuff. So you'll have that as well. A reminder to sign up for next week's program with Broadway and television actor Eleanor Risa. And Nadine, you had one program you wanted to talk about.
So on May 5th, I will be in conversation with Billy Vera, who is an incredible musician who also worked for Specialty Records. And the conversation will be about the life and time of Art Roop and Specialty Records. And that'll be on May 5th at 4:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Yes, Loren?
No, actually, Billy and I are both hosts on the same radio station.
Oh!
KSDS out of San Diego. I'm on Sunday afternoons, and I forgot what weeknight he's on, but I heard him interviewed recently. I mean, what a fascinating figure he is, my Lord.
So he got to start, really, at Specialty Records, working with my cousin Art, and has has so many fabulous stories to share. Yeah. So that will just be on May 5th. Yeah.
And that program just came together today. So we will have it up on our website by tomorrow. So people can start registering for that. Again, everybody, thank you for joining us. Thank you again, Loren, Eric, and Nadine. And we will see everybody next time.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Eric and Loren.
Thank you, Eric.
And bye, everyone.
Bye, Loren. Bye, Nadine. Bye, everyone.